Here we go. 3.
Michigan, as around 300 protesters, some of them armed, convert
people waiting in line for hours.
This is a crisis, a pandemic, an epidemic, or whatever you want to call it.
Tonight, anger in the streets across America, massive crowds gathering again.
Now surpassing 4 million, the total doubling in only 6 weeks.
In New York, a city still on lockdown, many are making their voices heard despite the risks of the pandemic.
In Florida, where cases are surging.
You can see the smoke continuing to billow as many, many buildings are on fire.
Are, quote, increasing the strain on the healthcare system.
And that city burn.
We live in a society that still sees
New COVID concerns as protests in the middle of the pandemic. The shattered glass from a night of rage.
Across the country, an ominous pattern.
A potential breakthrough in COVID tracking. As California reports its highest number of virus deaths in one day.
That has just been either broken into or burned to the ground.
California filled with
Dr. Anthony Fauci.
And take a look at this scene in Orlando.
Well, good day, good evening, whenever you're watching. Daytime for me, so glad you're joining us today. Wise up, wise up. We need radical wisdom. We are living in radical times, and it's hard to know what to do. It's hard to know how to process, hard to know how to prove these, how to process these things. So let's try to find some wisdom. Now, I mentioned last week that sometimes people confuse smart and wise. They are not the same thing. There are many intelligent people who do not make wise choices. So I wanted to give you an example today, again, of smart but not wise. Well, for that matter, maybe not all that smart either. So I kind of told you guys last week, this is part of our What Were You Thinking? I told you guys last week about a trip that myself and some friends made to Canada right before I went in the Air Force, and we were stranded on this lake in a storm, and there was a shack, the Tilton Hilton, and we went in the shack and started a fire, and bats started flying around, and I told you about my friend Billy, who was kind of freaked out by that whole thing. And so the next year, I was in the Air Force. They came out here from Chicago. Three of us were the same guys. And we took a road trip up the West Coast, up Highway 1, all the way up to Seattle. But on our way up there, we stopped on Mount Rainier. We were driving around on Mount Rainier. I got a picture here of the group. Here we go. So that is a carving log, they call it, up in the Redwood Forest. And in the picture, that's me sitting up on top of the log, and right below me is my friend Randy Shimizu. Many of you have met him. To the side of him, leaning against the log, is Billy. And Billy, let's go to this picture. There's Billy. And he's actually wearing my hat that I showed you guys last week, my Yamaha fishing hat. And, here it is. I've got it right here with me. You know, this is 40 or 50 years old now. It's actually starting to come unsewed, but I still have it. And there's a picture of Billy wearing it. Let's go full screen on that again. Because this story is about Billy. We were up on Mount Rainier, and it was just beautiful. None of us had ever seen a sight like that before, and there was this stream running down the mountain, a pretty good size. It was a river. It's a small river. And Billy was very bold, very adventurous, athletic and everything. And so we're looking at this river, and there's a rock probably 10 feet out in the middle of the river, pretty good size rock. And Billy said, I want to get my picture on that rock. So he took a long running leap, and he jumped out, and he landed on that rock in the middle of the river. And this is fast water. This is white water going down here. And we got his picture. I couldn't find it. This is the only picture I could find. But he jumped on that rock, and we took his picture. And then he thought, I can't take my run to get a good distance to get back to the shore from here. How am I going to get back? He stood out there for the longest time, and he's looking at the rock, and he's looking at the span of water, and he's thinking, I can maybe get one or two steps. Not so wise to think, I can get out there. Can I get back? As it played out, he stood there for a while, and he finally jumped as best he could, and he hit the water, but close enough to get out of the river. We were worried about it for a while because it was the kind of water you didn't want to get stuck in. So smart, but not so wise, maybe not so smart. Anyway, so there's Billy. Here's actually, I gave you a picture of me too, sitting up on top of the rock about a year into the Air Force, and with my friend Scott next to me. So what is wisdom? What is wisdom? Wisdom is an expertise. This is the dictionary definition. It is an expertise in dealing with difficult questions of life and adaptation to complex requirements. And we are certainly in a time in this nation, a time of difficult questions. We're in a time when it's difficult to adapt to complex requirements, and we don't really know what to do sometimes. We don't know what's happening. We don't know what's happening next. How do we respond? And wisdom is what we need. Wisdom is also the quality of having experience, knowledge, and good judgment. It's the quality of being wise. And we all need wisdom. Well, God can give it to us. And I showed this scripture last week. I want to show it again, because it's James. Jesus' brother wrote this and said, "If you need wisdom," which we certainly do today, "ask our generous God and he will give it to you. He will not rebuke you for asking." That's an incredible promise. If you need wisdom, ask God. He'll give it to you. Now, I mentioned last week that the leadership of this church needs wisdom as it relates to reopening the church. And I asked you through this series on wisdom, I would like you to pray for the leadership of this church as we wrestle with this issue. We have developed a list of questions that we want to ask you, the congregation, about how we proceed at this point. We're going to begin calling people this week. We expect to make an announcement next week pending the results of our survey. We have something that we intend to do, but we're going to wait until we get a little closer and see how it plays out. And we should make that announcement next week. Now, speaking of next week, we want to do something a little different. Normally, today is the first Sunday of the month. It'll be a communion Sunday, but we're postponing that until next week because we want to do something a little different. We want to offer drive-through communion. Drive-through communion. What it is we want to invite you to come on campus. We're going to have a couple stations set up where we can serve you communion through your car window, prepackaged like the ones we've been using so far. So they will be untouched. They will be clean. There's no concern about a virus. We will serve you those little cups. We will pray for you without you ever having to leave your car. And it may seem a little odd, but the idea is it's a bit of a personal touch, and I think we need that. So we want to invite you next week at 9 o'clock to drive through communion. You can take the elements right there in your car if you like, or take them home for our online service, which will start at 10 o'clock and will include a communion element. So you should get a call this week about our survey for reopening, and as part of that, we'll ask you if you'd like to be part of the drive through communion, or if you would like to have the elements delivered to your house like we've done at points in the past. Okay, before we jump into the heart of the message, let's pray. Lord, we ask for your wisdom, even in how we hear your word, how we hear you speak. We pray that you would open our ears, open our hearts to receive what you have for us, to understand a little more of who you are and what you desire for us. And we thank you, Lord. We ask your blessing. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, as we get started, grab your Bible. Let's hope it's right there by you. You're at home. You can keep it on a table. If you need to run any other room and get it, I would encourage you to do that. But we'd like you to follow along with what we're doing, the texts we're reading. So we are going to be reading out of Proverbs 2. And I'm going to read a good bit of the chapter, and I encourage you to follow along. Got a subtitle called The Benefits of Wisdom. And here's what King Solomon in Jerusalem writes. "My child, listen to what I say. Treasure my commands. Tune your ears to wisdom. Concentrate on understanding. and cry out for insight, ask for understanding. Search for them as you would search for silver. Seek them like hidden treasure. And then you will understand what it means to fear the Lord, and you will gain knowledge of God. For the Lord grants wisdom. That's what James said. Ask and God will give it to you. The Lord grants wisdom. From his mouth come knowledge and understanding. He grants a treasure of common sense to the honest. He is a shield to those who walk with integrity. He guards the paths of the just, protects those who are faithful to him. And then you will understand what is right and what is just and what is fair, and you will find the right way to go. And that is, in our culture, there are so many voices competing for what is right, what is just, what is fair, and so many different paths we could go. But when we gain wisdom from the Lord, we will understand the answers to those. Verse 10, for wisdom will enter your heart, and knowledge will fill you with joy, and wise choices will watch over you. Understanding will keep you safe. Wisdom will save you from evil people, from those whose words are twisted. These men turn from the right way to walk down dark paths. They take pleasure in doing wrong. They enjoy the twisted ways of evil. Their actions are crooked and their ways are wrong. And jumping down to verse 21, for only the godly will live in the land, and those with integrity will remain in it. But the wicked will be removed from the land, and the treacherous will be uprooted. Those are good promises for us, to know that God ultimately stops the evil, stops the wickedness that so often fills our society. But we have to make sure that we don't have that wickedness and evil inside of us. How do we do that? Well, let's break down a couple verses of this passage that I just read. Tune your ears to wisdom. As a musician, I love this, because it means being in sync, being connected. Like on a guitar, for instance, if I play a string and the guitar is in tune, all the other strings vibrate sympathetically. They pick up on the vibrations from that one string, and they all hum lightly in tune with it. When it's in tune, there's a connection, a unity, a sympathetic feeling and mood. So tune your ears to wisdom. Concentrate on understanding. Think about these things. Concentrate on trying to understand and asking God to help you understand. And then in verse 3 it says, cry out for insight. Lord, give me insight. Ask for understanding. Lord, help me understand. It just like Solomon did, and God granted his request, just like James tells us to. Cry out for insight. Ask for understanding. And verse 4, search for them as you would for silver. Seek them like hidden treasures. Wisdom is treasure. Wisdom is more valuable than all the things we accumulate. To have an understanding of life and to make it through life in a healthy way. You heard the benefits as I was reading through chapter 2 of Proverbs there. But the question is how? How to tune your ears? How to search as you would for a treasure? Well, you have to spend time in God's Word. That's where it comes from. Wisdom comes from God. Wisdom comes from listening to what He says. That's the source of wisdom. And the thing that wisdom teaches us is to trust God. Wisdom teaches us to trust God. Now, we're used to a similar phrase in American society. This one here. In God we trust. That's an American statement. In God we trust. Or do we? Do we really? You know, it's on our money. In God we trust. Can't miss it right there. On our paper money. It's on our coins. In God we trust. It's an interesting story of how this all came about. This phrase appeared on coins for the first time in the North during the Civil War, and it was meant to remind people that the goal of the Civil War was a godly goal, to give freedom to those caught in slavery. And one of the clergymen who was promoting this idea said that if we put this on our money, if we made this an obvious statement, it would place the North under divine protection, is what he believed. And then a couple of years later, still during the Civil War, a group of Protestant denominations got together, and they wanted to amend the preamble to the Constitution of the United States. They wanted to insert this phrase, that Americans recognized Almighty God as the source of all authority and power in civil government. They wanted to put that right into the preamble of the Constitution. And of course, that idea is what the Bible says. It says that's true. God is the ultimate source of all authority and power, and God delegates to who he chooses. That's what the Bible says. But that amendment did not pass. The majority of the country was not in favor of it. Then in the late 19th century, coins were redesigned, and the phrase "In God We Trust" disappeared. And it stayed off of our money until Eisenhower put it on all money in 1955. In God We Trust, and it is still on our money. And in 1956, the year I was born, that phrase was adopted as the first official motto of the United States. And now some would say that "In God We Trust" reflects certain American values. It's, you know, I think, for me, I think back to the 50s and I think back to the 60s and the image that we have of those days and the Andy Griffith Show and Leave It to Beaver and all that kind of perspective. And so that's heartwarming to a lot of people. And they want to return to those things. But, you know, not everyone remembers those years quite so fondly. See, we tend to forget the bad things and romanticize the rest of it. But in reality, it wasn't always so good back in the 50s and 60s. You know, much of our population was still oppressed by Jim Crow laws. And let's not forget when JFK was shot. Those aren't our good memories, are they? I remember as a kid, up till the time I was probably about 10 years older, we'd have to go out in the hallway of the school and kneel down by the brick wall there with our heads down to be ready for when they drop the nuclear weapons on us. I mean, that'll put a chill in you. It wasn't the perfect little world that we remember. They might kill us all with nuclear weapons. So we want to go back, but maybe it's not what we remembered, you know. And the thing is, in God we trust, for much of U.S. history, those values that we're thinking about from that era, they tend to rise and fall. They're strong now, and then you have a hard time finding them. In other words, in God we trust does not reflect universal American values. Instead, it represents a particular political and religious perspective. And when we try to apply it to the whole nation, including people who do not believe in God, who don't trust in God, it becomes a lie. It becomes a lie. We may really like the idea, but that statement does not represent this country, and I don't think it ever has. We get a little confused, and sometimes we think, you know, this country was founded on Christian principles, and actually that's not entirely true either. You know, several of the primary founders, Thomas Jefferson and Thomas Paine and Benjamin Franklin, were deists. They believed God created the world. They believed in God, but they believed God created the world, then walked away and has nothing else to do with his creation. And that is certainly not the perspective that Christians have. So I'm not sure how much this phrase ever represented us. But it gets tangled up with things. Now, you may not like this part that I'm about to go into. You see things like this a lot. A cross and a flag. I understand the sentiment, but I don't like it. I feel like it cheapens the cross. You know, I love the flag. I love what it represents. I'm a veteran. I would still be willing to go and fight for this country. I think athletes should stand for the national anthem. But this flag is less than 250 years old, and it does not compare to the instrument of the cross that God used to redeem the entire world. It's not the same thing. And yet, sometimes we conflate that. We try to associate the ideas. And then it becomes even worse because we drift from "in God we trust," which is not a bad philosophy, but then we drift into "in politics we trust." Even from church people, you know, I see more on Facebook about politics than I do about faith. If I had to guess your priorities from what people post on Facebook, I'd have to say it's politics. But the thing is, as soon as we trust anything other than God, we have become unwise. Nothing else is dependable. Everything and everyone will eventually fail us. If you trust a government, even the American government, which I still believe has been the greatest country ever, but if you trust the government, your trust is misplaced, and that is unwise. And after all, realize this, at the moment, the government, for the most part, does not seem to be supporting Christian concerns. And what's more, we have organizations here, American organizations, so to speak, that are trying to eliminate the phrase "in God we trust." They take it to the Supreme Court and try to get it declared unconstitutional. And that fact alone shows that the motto is not true for this country. It's not true. It's true for individuals. The best we can do is to say, "In God I trust." That is a great statement. In God I trust. But maybe the most serious threat here comes from people who claim to have put their trust in God, and yet they live their daily lives as though their trust was anywhere and everywhere else. So in light of the fact that so many people do not trust God, what is it that people trust? Well, I Googled, and I found Google. Here's this headline from this website. "Americans trust Amazon and Google more than the police or the government." So you Google who people trust and you get Google as an answer. They trust Google and Amazon to do what is right more than they trust teachers, police officers, Donald Trump, the U.S. government, or the news media. And this is according to a nationwide survey. And the Google thing is interesting because when Google formed and was growing, they decided they need a corporate ethos, a philosophy that would guide their policy and such. And they decided on this: do the right thing. Do the right thing, which was also expressed as don't be evil. Now, shouldn't you be able to trust someone with that as their guiding philosophy? Do the right thing, don't be evil. Those are great ideas. Except, who gets to define good and evil in this context? Who gets to define good and evil? Because Google has faced criticism recently because it seems to censor conservative views. To them, conservative views are evil. So who gets to define evil? And who do people trust? So here's the rest of the survey. I think the ultimate conclusion is this: Americans don't trust anyone. I think we're all gotten pretty cynical. Here was the number one answer in the survey: your primary doctor. People said your primary doctor will tell you the truth, but that only received 50% of the votes, which means that half of us don't trust our doctors. The number two answer was the military. And then Google and Amazon, trusted by over 30% of the people. And then the lowest level of trust included. Man, I hate that you guys aren't here. I want to look out at you and I want to ask you this question right now. So I'm going to do it anyway. Okay, what was the fourth lowest level of trust? Yes. The media, that's right. The media at 8% of people trust the media. Okay, and next lowest was the government and politicians. Yes, that is correct. They were at 7%. Next is, anybody? No. Okay, the next was Wall Street at 5%, and the lowest level of trust that people gave to any American organization or entity or concept was Hollywood. Now, that's kind of encouraging to me. Nobody trusts Hollywood. They were down at 4%. So if we don't trust all these things, what do we trust? If we're not trusting God, if we're not trusting these things, what do we trust? Well, I think ultimately, a lot of people trust money. They feel if you got enough money, you're going to be okay. Even in these times of turmoil, you know, maybe you have enough money that even if you lose your job for a while, you're going to be okay. You got enough money to retire, we're going to be able to make it. Because money is what's important. Money is what gets us through. And people trust money. People trust relationships. They build their security around the people around them. And that's not necessarily bad. I've said this before. It could be family. Of course, you should have some trust in that. And, you know, friends, of course, that should be a source of people that we could trust. And a lot of people trust themselves, basically. We trust ourselves. Which was an interesting concept. I Googled that too. You know, you can trust Google because it's more trustworthy than teachers. So I Googled this, trust yourself. And I got to tell you the top two responses. I love this. So I Googled trust yourself. And the first response was from the magazine Psychology Today. And they had an article about how important it is psychologically to trust yourself. And the next response was from another magazine that said, 8 reasons you can't trust yourself as demonstrated by psychology. So the one says you got to trust yourself. The other one says you can't trust yourself. Not only that, there's 8 reasons you can't trust yourself. And it takes some real wisdom to get through this and figure out which of those is right, if either one of them is right. Who is right? What is right? How do we make it through that in such radical times? Well, here's a statement of true wisdom. This is from the book of Proverbs, which we've been studying. We just read Proverbs 2. Well, this is in the next chapter, Proverbs 3. And it says this, Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Do not depend on your own understanding. Seek His will in all that you do, and He will show you which path to take. That is a statement of wisdom. And I want to break it down a little bit here from those 4 little sections that are in there. The first one is this: put your trust in the Lord. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, all of it. No holding back, no doubt, no fear. Remember that when things happen that you can't control, and there's much of that going on these days in our society, you trust God, you trust His presence in your life, you trust His love for you, and you trust His promise to care for you. 2 weeks ago, we looked at Psalm 91, which went through that in detail. We can trust God. And then here's this next line, which I think is maybe the most difficult for us. But it says this: do not depend on your own understanding. Oh, that's tough, because that's what we want to do. You know, you may be pretty smart, but I got to tell you something. You have limitations. I have limitations. Everyone has limitations, no matter how smart they are. God does not. I mean, don't think that you understand any kind of situation better than God does. It may look like you should do this, or maybe you should do that. It may seem to make sense to do this, or it may seem to make sense not to do that. But your understanding is limited, and you cannot fully trust it. Do not depend on your own understanding. It may be when something unexpected happens in your life, something scary perhaps, and you may not know how to process it. But here's the thing, you don't have to understand everything. God understands. Put your trust in Him. Next, seek His will in all you do. Boy, it is so tempting to pursue our own will, especially based on our own understanding, you know? Sometimes we think we want to do this or we want to do that, and maybe we kind of have good motivations. Maybe it's we think this is right or we think that is right. This is the smart thing, this is the stupid thing. And all the while, we're doing the really stupid thing, which is moving forward without truly seeking God's will, by praying over a situation, by gaining wisdom from Scripture, by seeking counsel from godly people. We move through life, we make major decisions with big impact, and we don't really seek God. We don't try to discover the wisdom. Seek His will in all you do. The way you manage different parts of your life, the decisions you make, you know, how do you spend your time? Time is one of the most precious things we have, and boy, do we waste it. So seek God's will in how you spend your time. Seek God's will in how you spend your money. A lot of us would be a lot better off financially if we could pull in that one. Seek God's wisdom in how you're going to raise your kids. I mean, wisdom is critical there. Seek God's will in how you interact with people, how you function with people, how you value people. Seek God's will. Here's an important one. Seek God's will regarding who you choose as friends. You find that theme recurring over and over again in the book of Proverbs. Seek God's will regarding what you put into your mind, what kind of movies you're watching, what kind of books you're reading. You know, I've gotten to the point where TV, I'm just kind of giving up on it, because it's like everything that's produced these days, there's no good guys. Everybody's compromised. I mean, obviously, we really are compromised as human beings, but we should have something to look up to, and I just get discouraged watching things that are out these days. Seek God's will in what you're putting in your mind. And when we do that, comes the next promise, which is a tremendous promise. He will show you which path to take. You know, trusting in God in these times of confusion will resolve the issue. He will show you which path to take. That can be a difficult decision, and sometimes it's not always apparent. We're faced with different paths, and they may look very different. And we don't know which one to take. Do we want to take the bright, sunny path? Or that one to the left where there's dead trees and where it looks kind of dark? You know, sometimes God may ask you to take a path that may not seem to make sense. It may not be the path you want to take. Maybe going down towards a dark area that you don't want to deal with. It may even seem foolish. But those who seek wisdom, I believe, according to Scripture, those who seek wisdom do not make foolish decisions. Because the definition of a fool, we covered last week, is those who do not seek wisdom. But it may take some real faith to step out on that path when it doesn't seem to make sense. But if that's the path that God shows, then wisdom says, take it. No matter how scary it may look, no matter if it doesn't seem to make sense. And that's why God says, don't trust in your own understanding. Trust in my understanding. Your understanding will let you down. But God will show you which path to take. I'm going to look at that. Look at the verse again. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Don't depend on your own understanding. Seek His will, and He will show you which path to take. Now, this verse is not saying that He's going to make your life easy. It means He will take you down the path that is most beneficial to you. The path that will help you grow in faith, the path that will help you grow in wisdom. He will give you a direction and a purpose in life. You will know where you're going and what you are doing. You will have confidence in knowing that you are where you are supposed to be at the right time. That's a great feeling. So trust the Lord is what it comes down to. He'll show you what to do. He'll show you where to go. And then all you have to do is obey. That's exactly what we're trying to do regarding reopening this church. Find God's wisdom, trust Him, then obey. There's two concepts in this. Trust and obey. It's not difficult. Seek God's wisdom, trust and obey. Believe God, do what he says, and that is the essence of wisdom. That's how you wise up, even in radical times. So I want you to think about what it is that you may trust today. Where do you put your confidence? Is it the government? Is it a politician? Is it yourself, your brains, or maybe like me, your good looks? Or maybe money? What is it? Hey, here's something that I've been thinking about. Gun sales are way up. What does that say about what people trust? Why are gun sales up? Because people are afraid and they think guns will give them security. You know, and I'm no different. They're placing trust in weapons. You know, a few weeks ago, things were going crazy around. I got the guns out and loaded them and made sure they were easily accessible, you know. But then it's like in my head I saw this image of waving my gun around at the same time I'm saying, in God I trust. And I'm thinking, how does that work? How does that work? I mean, if I felt like that image, in God I trust, in God I trust, looked pretty silly, you know? Here's the thing. Whatever it is that you trust, God says it doesn't measure up. Even if it's your money or whatever, you know, even if your money gets you through tough times in this life, if it gets you through radical times, it's not going to do you any good when you die. We all stand in judgment before God. The only thing that makes a difference at the time of judgment is if we live this life with a determination to trust and obey. Wisdom is keeping a focus on what lies beyond this world. This world and our presence in it is temporary. We live in radical times, but God's radical wisdom is greater than the chaos and the hatred and a dysfunction of this life. So wise up. Wise up. And spend some time this week looking at what the Bible has to say about wisdom, especially the book of Proverbs. And the thing that's so cool about Proverbs is it's short, easily understood little snippets of wisdom, like this one. I just pulled this out at random. Proverbs 4:18-19 says, the way of the righteous is like the first gleam of dawn. I love this description. It's like the first gleam of dawn, which shines ever brighter. You know, when the sun starts coming up, it just starts getting brighter and brighter and more light, and you can see more clearly. And the way of the righteous is like the first gleam of dawn, which shines ever brighter until the full light of day. But the way of the wicked is like total darkness. They have no idea what they're stumbling over. So wise up. It's going to make a difference in your life, especially in these radical times. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for your wisdom. We thank you for your word. We thank you that when we come to you and ask for understanding and ask for wisdom and ask for knowledge, you give it to us. And when we have that, Lord, we can make good decisions. We can move forward with confidence. The world becomes brighter and brighter. We can see more clearly and understand more completely. We thank you for that, Lord. Help us to follow you. Help us to lean on you. Lord, we pray that you would change us to make us more fit for your kingdom, that you would change us into who you want us to be. Give us the wisdom to follow you. We thank you, Lord. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Now we're changing it. 1, 2. Good.
can trust.